Welcome to Theological Thursday, where we contemplate important questions, like how the little engine could. Psych! Let's get theoretical!
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Collier and Mr. Herbers.
And welcome to Channel 58 News.
We have no news to report at this time.
Therefore, we are going to send you to Jilpin to bore you to death with the physics of track.
Jilpin, take it away!
I'm here with Coach Kwestinski of the Marquette High Track Team. Now, Coach, can you tell me, from a track perspective, what is the importance of acceleration?
Well, I'll tell you, Steve, we teach acceleration because it's so important for athletes to maximize their overall speed in a race. Take 100 meters, for example. If we were going to have an athlete run 100 meters from point zero, from a dead stop in the blocks, he's going to be accelerating probably up and through about 30 meters of that race. So for the first 30 meters, we would work on him going from time zero to a set amount of meters per second that we would like to see that athlete run in the race. Much as possible deceleration, which they can't do physically. So we try to.
Coach, can you tell us a little bit about the physics involved in track?
Well, certainly, Steve, I'd love to do that. We can take a look at the 100 meter race, and we can look at these particular factors in the 100 meter race. We can look at average acceleration over the entire race, or we can look at average acceleration over a set amount of time. So usually the athlete's starting at time zero, and that would be his velocity initial. Velocity, of course, is meters per second. He's starting out at zero. His velocity at 30 meters, we could time to see how long it took him to get to 30 meters, and that would give us our velocity final in this case for this phase of his race. And then what we can tell is what his average acceleration is through the acceleration phase of his race. We could also do acceleration through the entire race if we wanted to, starting at velocity initial and velocity final. In the max velocity phase, what we'd like to do is max.
We were both young when I first saw you. I close my eyes and the flashback starts. I'm standing there on a balcony in summer air. See the lights, see the party, the ball gowns. See you make your way through the crowd and say hello. Little did I know that you were Romeo, you were throwing.
Okay, we're rolling. Linear acceleration. Okay, so we took two measurements, time and change in position. So we had 60 feet, the mats were 60 feet long, or 30 feet long, and there were two of them. We converted feet to meters, and so assuming constant acceleration down here, first we found the average velocity was 5.02 meters per second. Okay, so then we assume constant acceleration, and we can get the final velocity because the initial velocity was zero. So final velocity is 10 meters per second, and then average acceleration is change in velocity over time. So we do math, and then 2.76 meters per second squared is our average velocity for Nathan.
You spin my head right round when you go down down.
You spin my head right around when you go down down.
Got the house with my swagger, hop in that whip, I got places to go. People to see, time is precious, I look at my Cartier out of control. Just like my mind where I'm going, the women, the shorties, know nothing but clothes. No stopping at my Pirelli's on, like my jewelry that's always on. I know the storm is coming. My pockets keep telling me it's gonna shower. Call up my homies, it's on and popping the night, cause it's meant to be ours. We keep a fadeaway shot cause we ballin'.
Okay, to find the centripetal acceleration of the vehicle as it goes in a circle, we first start with timing how long it took for her to drive in a circle, which we get 9.15 plus or minus 0.01 seconds, and she was driving at 10 miles per hour the entire time. Then we convert 10 miles per hour into meters per second. Using all the conversion factors, we get 4.47 meters per second. To that, we use the formula for circumference, and in this case, circumference is equal to the distance she traveled. So to find the distance traveled, we do the 4.47 meters per second times the time, 9.15 meters per second. We get 40.9042 meters. Then, changing the circumference equation around a little, we get circumference equals 2 pi r. And plugging in all the numbers, we get r to be equal to 6.5101 meters. Now that we have the radius, we can find centripetal acceleration. The equation for centripetal acceleration is the radius times angular speed squared. To find the angular speed, we use a conversion factor from radians to meters. It's 2 pi equals 40.9042 meters, and we get 0.6866 radians per second for the angular speed. Plugging in the value for the radius and then the angular speed that we just found, we get centripetal acceleration to be equal to 6.5101 meters per radian times 0.6866 radians per second quantity squared, and the centripetal acceleration, it is equal to 3.07 meters per second squared.
I still hear your voice when you sleep next to me. I still feel your touch in my dream. Forgive me my weakness, but I don't know why. Without you, it's hard to survive. Cause every time we touch, I get this feeling.
Stand back. I'm going to try science. Here we are. We are converting the numbers. The bowling ball had a velocity of 1.779 meters per second. And we converted the radius to meters, so we had sufficient units. Once we had the velocity, we converted it to angular speed using the radius. The final angular speed was 7.996 radians per second. Once we had that, and we found the time using the video, we found the acceleration to be 1.23 radians per second squared. How nifty. Then, once we had the angular acceleration, we can find the torque. So using the moment of inertia, which is here, and the angular acceleration, we found the torque to be 0.133 newton meters per radius. And then, finally, using the torque, we decided to find the friction. So the force of friction was 0.596 newtons. And the coefficient of friction was 0.011. Wow.
So Charlie, tell me, what have you learned in your sophomore physics class about uncertainty?
We don't know exactly how long friction acted on the bowling ball, because it didn't start spinning immediately.
That's certain, folks.
Wow, all those types of acceleration. I never knew.
Neither did I. I almost fainted a couple times today. So surprising.
Yeah, you just don't think about that sometimes.